Yes, class. So we were discussing collision in the last class. So let us complete a smaller portion is left. So basically, two formula of velocity we had seen, and what was collision firstly? We had seen that in collision, two objects are coming, two masses are coming, they get collided at a point, and then after collision, their velocities get exchanged. Not exactly exchange, or velocities become different. Suppose initially it was u1 and u2. After it becomes v1 and v2. That is what we have studied in collision. Then there were two formulas of velocity. V1 is equal to u1 into m1 minus m2 plus 2 m2 u2 divided by m1 plus m2. Secondly, v2 is equal to u2 m2 minus m1 plus m1 2 m1 u1 divided by m1 plus m2. These two formulas should be there with you, and you should remember it. Then lastly, we had stopped at the special cases. So first special case, if the bodies are identical. This means that the bodies are identical. M1 is equal to M2, then this is what we get. Second case is class. If they are unidentical, and they are unidentical in such a manner that the first body and the size of the second body, these are way too different. First body is very small and second body is comparatively bigger. In that case, what you have to do? So that's what we have to study. So see class, when we are seeing a bigger mass like M2 is present, a bigger mass like M2 is present. So in that case, when we are referring to M2, in that case, our M1 minus M2 will approximately still be equal to M2 only. And M1 plus M2 will be equal to M2 only. Means either you add both the masses or you subtract both the masses, you will get the bigger mass. It's like in 1000, you are subtracting one, still you will get 1000. In 1000, you are adding one. Approximately, you will get 1000 only. 1001 and 1000, they are so in approximation that we always round it off and write it as 1000. So similarly, here too. U1 is there with a velocity as a velocity of the first mass, which is smaller. Okay, now what will be the difference in the formula? Did you get it? M1 is smaller, M2 is bigger. M1, M2 are colliding. Okay, so M1 minus M2 can also be written as M2. M1 plus M2 can also be written as M2. It's like 1000 minus 1 is 999. Which is approximately equal to 1000 only. So M2 minus M1 is equal to M2 only. Or 1000 plus 1 is equal to 1001, which is M1 plus M2 equal to M2 only. This is what we are studying right now in this case. So let's put the formula. V1 is equal to U1 M1 minus M2 plus 2 M2 U2 divided by M1 plus M2. Okay, this is the case. Now, one thing, there is a very good condition associated with the second velocity. If two objects are present, one object is so huge and so big. Okay, the second object is very huge and very big. And the first one is coming. So when they are colliding, smaller object needs to cover a greater distance in order to collide with the bigger one. Bigger object doesn't need to move in this case, right? The bigger object doesn't need to move in this case. So smaller one is M1, bigger one is M2. So M2 need not roll over with a greater velocity in order to compete with M1 to collide with it. No, M2 is a bigger mass. When they are moving, when they are colliding, first of all, M2 will have no effect on itself because it is huge, right? So that's why we take the initial velocity of M2 as zero only. M2 is at rest. M1 has to cover that much distance in order to overcome the bigger, huge mass of M2 and then collide. This is the difference which you have to remember. So one thing for sure in the formula, U2 will definitely be zero. Here, look, this U2 will be zero. So you are left with C. Here in this term, this is U1. M1 minus M2 is written as M2. And M1 plus M2 is also written as M2. M2, M2 gets cancelled. So v1 becomes equal to u1. In the previous identical case, what were we getting? We were getting that v1 became equal to u2. Second bodies, right? In this case, this is exactly getting interchanged. v1 to u1, v2 so u2. Here it will be, if it is v2, it will be equal to u2. Okay. M2's velocity, see, M2 is a huge mass and M1 is coming. Now, usually what happened when both the bodies were identical, this had to cover a little more greater distance, but this also had to move. And then at a point, both bo the bodies were able to collide with each other. Both the collision used to occur, right? Now, this is very big. This need not move. Automatically, this will cover with a greater velocity and will be colliding with it. That's why this need not move. So, we take the velocity of this as v. Okay, Zainab, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Write down this case, then we'll see the common final velocity and all. Okay, case three also, let me tell you. In case three, just the opposite. Bigger mass is m1. So, same theory. In the denominator, we'll have m1, right? 2m1 divided by m1. That's the case what you have to follow. So, in this case, m1, the initial velocity is u1, m2 with a velocity u2. Difference is that u2, m2 is very small, m1 is huge. So, v1 is equal to u1, v2 is equal to 2u. When you will calculate, you will see that 2 is left because m is there in the form. Write it. Write the special cases, and if someone has any doubts in this, please let me know. And do not write it as it is. Put it in the formula and then see, are you all getting this or not? Zainab, have you used the formula? Why are you getting 2m2u2? For the second velocity, it will be 2m1u1.
No, I didn't see that. So M1.
Just check it. Other students, what were your answers for this? Okay, let's discuss the next portion. Other students, please, you also respond. See, in elastic collision, what we have studied that there is conservation of momentum, right? M1U1 plus M2U2. Okay, Zainab, now you're getting it. Okay, good. So see, in inelastic collision in 1D, M1 is there with U1 velocity, M2 is there with U2 velocity, and both M1 and M2 have collided, and now the velocities have been interchanged, that is V1 and V2. So there is conservation of momentum over here, right? M1 U1 plus M2 U2, which were the initial portions, are now equal to M1 V1 plus M2 V2. Okay. Right? So m1 u1 plus m2 v2. Now we get a common velocity. Look, class, in inelastic collision, how can you identify inelastic collision? The bodies stick together and move. They stick together and move together. So if both of these are moving with a common velocity, both are moving together, so they'll be obviously having the same velocity. Remember, in inelastic, this one, perfectly inelastic collision, the bodies stick to each other. If it is not perfectly inelastic, then they won't stick to each other. So this is how you can identify perfectly inelastic. This is how you can identify perfectly inelastic collision. So you have m1 u1 plus m2 u2 is equal to m1 b plus m2 b. Now let's take, this is m1 u1 plus m2 u2. So take V common and we are left with M1 plus M2. So what is V equal to? M1 U1 plus M2 U2 divided by M1 plus M2. Okay, so what is this V? This is the common final. Common final velocity. And if you have to calculate the loss in the kinetic energy, how can you calculate? The loss in the kinetic energy will be equal to kinetic energy initial minus kinetic energy final. Yes, you will get your answer as negative, and that minus sign will only show you that there is a loss in the kinetic energy. Okay, write it. We'll see a question also based on this. See, in this, first mass is 2 kgs. The velocity is 5 meter per second. This is meter per second. Okay. Second body is 3 kg meter per second, 2 meter. 3 kg is the mass and 2 meter per second is the velocity. Now, when both the bodies are colliding, you can see from the figure that they are sticking to each other. So, if they are sticking to each other, it means this is a case of perfectly inelastic collision. So you have to know this also, and if you know it's a case of perfectly inelastic collision, directly you can jump to the common velocity formula. So 2, 5, 3, and 2. So what will be the velocity? Velocity will be 5 into 2 plus 3 into 2 divided by total mass you will add it. So it will be straight away 3 plus 2. So this is 10 plus 6 by 5. Velocity is equal to 16 by 5 meter per second. Okay, write it, then we'll see. So these were the 1D cases. Now we'll just see the 2D cases, which are shorter. 16L5. Okay, 16 by 5 you're writing. Yes, Zainab, correct, correct. Write it.
Ma'am, can you scroll up?
See, yes, elastic collision in 2D. Now, 1D we have completed, one dimensions we have completed, two dimensions we are going to see. Now, in two dimensions, what is the exact difference that is going to come? Basically, you have the velocities and the bodies getting deviated at a certain angle. So, the first thing that you have to do is the resolution. Okay, the first thing that you have to do here is the resolution of velocity. That is important. So v1 cos theta along x-axis, v1 sine theta perpendicular. Similarly, v2 cos theta along the axis, v2 sine theta perpendicular. So how do you calculate it? You will be then, after resolving, x and y axis have to be calculated and dealt separately. So conservation of momentum along x-axis, m1 u1 plus m2 u2. Now, all the cos theta components are coming along the x-axis. V1 cos theta, V2 cos theta. V1 cos theta, V2 cos theta. So, M1 will be multiplied to V1 cos theta. M2 will be multiplied to V2 cos theta. So, this was M1 U1. This is M2 U2. But this becomes M1 V1. Instead of M1 V1, we are getting M1 V1 cos theta. And here we are getting M2 V2 cos theta. Now, along y-axis class, everything is getting cancelled. So, your net momentum is zero. You have M1 V1 sine theta 1 minus M2 V2 sine theta 2. So let's bring this on the opposite side. So M2 V2 sine theta 2 sine theta 2 is equal to M1 V1 sine theta 1. So in this case, we know elastic collision it is, so kinetic energy is conserved. That's why that table is very important, which we were discussing yesterday. So this is conserved. Let's write about the kinetic energy too. Half m1 u1 square plus half m2 u2 square is equal to half m v1 square plus half m v2 square. Okay, no, this will be m1, this will be m2. So this is how you can use kinetic energy, and now whatever quantity is missing you can use. Start writing from this. No, v1 only, v1, the final velocity, na, then initial velocity was there, that time the bodies didn't separate and then couldn't collide. Yes, Shyama, both of the thetas can be same. It is possible if they are colliding at an angle and when they are separating, that angle is same. It is definitely possible. So both the theta are different. That is the ideal case that we are taking. Okay. We cannot take a case now where it is symmetrically getting separated. All right. Just text all of you once completed in here, then I'll start the next chapter. See, Shaima, the bodies will be sticking together. So there won't be any angle of separation between them. That's why we are not taking inelastic collision in 2D. And there's a case when both the bodies are present and they are not getting stick together. That is not there in your syllabus. Okay. So just focus on elastic collision in 2D. That's enough. Okay, class. Now chapter 7, motion of system of particles and rotational motion. Basically, this chapter is rotational motion. Now, a major portion of it we have already completed when we were discussing circular motion. Basics of circular motion, in that we have already completed the basics of the rotation also. Like you already know what is angular velocity. You already know what is angular acceleration. You know what is angular displacement. Displacement and angular displacement, these are two different things, right? So please revise it also, because in rotation that will be constantly needed. Okay, just a second. Let me start with this. Okay, yes, class. Now let us start with the first concept, which is the concept of a rigid body. Now, what is meant by a rigid body? See, this we'll be discussing when we have the mechanical properties of solids, and we'll have mechanical properties of fluids too. So in that case, we'll be discussing what is rigid body in solids also. But before that, you should know what is a rigid body. Firstly, rigid bodies have certain properties. One thing is that they have a fixed shape. Due to environment, their shapes are not going to be hampered. Okay, so they have a fixed shape. All the points are in close contact. All the points are in close contact. What is meant by this means, if a point is here, a point is here, a point is here, a point is here, and they are so close that when you look at this appears like a straight line. Now, deforming forces are there which act on the rigid body, but the shape does not change. Means no change in configuration. No change in config. Duration. That's a rigid body, fixed body. Now, during motion, separation between two points on a rigid body does not change. Means if these two points are present, so the separation when this body is moving with some velocity, this separation will not change. Body's points are fixed. The points are also rigid. Each and every point which you see, these are also rigidly fixed. Okay, that's what you have to know when you are studying this chapter. Now, system of particles, what is the meaning of this chapter? Motion of system of particles and rotational motion. Rotational motion, you know, this rotational motion component has a major portion of circular motion. So you already know rotational motion. That is nothing different for you, and because we've already studied a portion of it, this is all about circular motion. But motion of system of particles. Motion of system of particles. Now, see, a rigid body is made up of particles. One particle is this, suppose one particle is this, and there is a finite separation between these two particles. They are separated by this distance. Now, when the body is in motion, each and every particle will also be in motion. This will be also moving. This will also be moving. So, when more particles are present, we say it's a system. System means group of particles. System basically means group of particles. group of particles. So these particles are present. Like if you see here, this is one particle which is present here. This is one particle which is present. So this is now a system. Now when this system is in motion, means both these particles, this is also moving, this one and this is also moving. So we say system of motion. Okay. A motion of system, sorry. So motion of system of particles. System means more than one particles. Particles means the distance between two rigid objects, and motion means their movement plus rotational motion. This is what is the meaning of this chapter. That's why this has a huge name, motion of system of particles and rotational motion. Rotational motion will come later. Center of mass, the first topic which with which we'll be starting, the center of mass. This means only that we are talking about the particles. So first let us focus on the particles. Then we'll see what is the meaning of these rotational components. Now, system of particles means system having more than one point mass, means group of particles. So they can be discrete, they can be continuous. Means in a system like this, one particle is present here, one particle is present here, one particle is present here, another particle is present here like this. So this is discrete manner, which you say diffusely present. Discrete means diffusely present. Continuous means in a organized array. Like this is the next particle. This is the next particle. Like this, in a continuous, organized array. Write it down. Okay, now see, there are three types of motions which are present. So first is translation motion. Translation motion means the body is just moving straight in a straight line. It can be up, it can be down, it can be right, it can be left. That is translation motion. Means in a straight manner. This is in a straight manner or straight line, motion in a straight line. So just understand, this is your motion in a straight line. In rotation motion, there will be an axis in rotational motion. And these, the body will be moving in a circular manner. So this was straight, this is circular. The body moves in a circular fashion. Okay, it can be around an axis, it can be directly just moving. That is rotation. And basically, there has to be an axis involved. Translation is also coming and body is moving also, like the tires. They are moving forward also and they are rotating also. This is called rolling motion. Okay, so translation motion is over. Rotation motion we'll be doing, and at the end we'll be doing rolling motion. Okay, write it. Done, Tas?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, so from center of mass, I'll start in the next weekend, okay?